Today I'm Louise Perry. The headlines: Hemel man denies attempted balcony murder, aid workers killed in suspected US airstrike, and new Premier League primary school programme. A man's denied trying to murder a woman in Hemel Hempstead this summer. The 21-year-old was seriously injured when she fell from the balcony of a block of flats in Waterhouse Street in July. 24-year-old John McCallier from Belsize Road appeared in St Albans Crown Court yesterday and pleaded not guilty to attempted murder. He'll be back there in November for the trial. The medical charity MSF says 9 of its workers died in a suspected US airstrike on a hospital in the Afghan city of Kunduz. There's been heavy fighting in the area between the Taliban and Afghan forces. MSF says the site of the hospital was well known to all sides. Charles Haviland has more details.
Médecins Sans Frontières said it was deeply shocked by the attack and the killing of its staff and patients. The charity said it had more than 100 patients and caregivers and over 80 foreign and Afghan staff in its trauma centre when it came under aerial attack. MSF has tweeted pictures of shocked staff and of medical operations continuing in surviving parts of the facility.
Passengers on the West Coast Main Line will be automatically compensated if they face delays of more than half an hour. Virgin's the first train company in the UK to introduce the system. The new scheme is available to those who buy advance tickets online or through the Virgin app and is expected to pay out around £3 million in compensation each year. The St Albans-based National Pharmacy Association says the future of smaller chemists is under threat. It says the removal of a subsidy from NHS England means many wouldn't afford to stay open. Graham Phillips runs 7 pharmacies in Hertfordshire and says it's unlikely he'd be able to keep his Elstree branch open.
You've got to think about the knock-on effect on the local population. So, for example, people pile up at the GP surgery, then the GP's surgery fills up and they go to A&E departments. So that's exactly what's happening.
The government's agreed a deal with the Premier League to provide every primary school in England and Wales with a school sports programme. The announcement comes as the Conservatives prepare for their party conference, which starts tomorrow. England could be knocked out of the Rugby Union World Cup at the group stage if they fail to beat Australia this evening, while Scotland could qualify for the next round with victory over South Africa. Elsewhere, the second of 3 matches is being held in Milton Keynes later when Samoa play Japan in Group B. Motorists are being advised there'll be a number of road closures in the area. Samoa head coach Stephen Beathen says they can't wait to play at Stadium MK.
Oh, it's been great. Milton Keynes is the one in a million stadium for us. We hardly ever get to see these sort of places, and you know, the boys are enjoying it. And saying that, all the other venues have been great since we've been here. We've been taken care of well, and you know, we have to do our job.
And the weather for Bedsarts and Bucks: a mix of cloud and sunshine with light winds and a high of 16 Celsius. Get the latest news and sport online at bbc.co.uk/3counties.
Three Counties Sport.
This afternoon, all our teams are in action. We'll bring you commentary on Watford.
Very, very, really exciting to lead this team because it's very, the emotion is very high.
MK Dons.
Opportunity, Murphy, 1-1, Josh Murphy.
Luton.
Rolls it in for McGeehan, who can't take the chance. Marriott does, though.
And Stevenage.
And Hitchcock, the response is immediate from Stevenage as Hitchcock rises.
As well as keeping you up to date with Wickham.
Right-footed effort, goal! Wickham Wanderers on the counter-attack.
Three Counties Sport.
Today from 2 here on BBC Three Counties Radio.
Across Beds, Hearts and Bugs.
Iain Lee and Katherine Boyle.
On BBC Three Counties Radio.
I pressed all those buttons there. Can I have a round of applause, please?
I was standing over your shoulder, virtually with string attached to every limb, manipulating you into pressing those buttons.
It.
Hi. You do the talky bit. I'm busy.
Hello,
online.
Welcome down the rabbit hole. This is the moment I've been dreaming about. I say dreams, more nightmares for the past 3 weeks, and it's finally happening. And we're here, and we're hoping that you'll join us. We haven't got a flipping clue beyond that, have we?
We're hoping that you'll join us. What kind of lazy, cliche-ridden nonsense is that?
This kind.
We don't listen. Okay, the show's going to evolve over the next few weeks. If it lasts that long, it might not. We don't quite know what it's going to be. And also, we don't quite know. And we were hoping that the young lady who's operating the kind of the outside, who's producing the show, would know all of the junctions we have to hit. By that, I mean the travel and the news and stuff. She ain't got a clue.
Thing was, she was surprised to see yours, never mind.
So she ain't got a clue. We ain't got a clue. Nobody's got a clue, and it's beautiful, what? Beautiful.
The phone number stays the same, though, right? So it's 03459-455-555.
Yeah.
I can see Colin in Dunstable's already rung us. Is he going to be the first
just
one?
Just turn your knob. You talk to Colin. I'm just going to play with my knobs.
Hang on a minute. He's not through yet. Oh, I'm preempting it because I can see him hovering over us in the distance.
You kind of want to reach up to about there. So just say hello.
Hello.
There we go. Perfect. That's what you want to do.
That's better.
So the way the show's going to work is, A, it's going to evolve over time. B, if you turn up at the building, you can't come in. But there is a gorgeous window onto Dunstable Downs.
Please keep your trousers on, but beyond that, do what you want.
If you come up to the window with a sign and hold it against the window, we will read that sign out, even if it's got profanity, although we might change the profanity to a flip or a crisp. But if you come up to... We won't let you in the building. That's only going to happen on the very last Saturday Down the Rabbit Hole show that we're going to do. But if you turn up at the window, you press a sign or a part of your body up against the window, we will acknowledge you. That will happen. And you can call. Anyone can call. 03459 455 555 is the telephone number. Now, I heard... I was in delightful Amersham this morning. Very posh. And I overheard a weird conversation. It was two women, and they were walking down, and they were trying to describe a colour.
Right.
You try describing a colour, ma'am.
We're women. That's what our job is.
Well, try... OK, describe blue.
The sea. Oh. Clear.
Well, the sea can be white.
No, I'm not talking about Blackpool. I'm talking about, you know, Caribbean. Think Enya.
Caribbean queen. Well, but that's not describing the colour. That's comparing the colour to something else.
Well, yeah, you need that in a description.
Well, no, you...
All right. See if you can do any better. Well, red.
Riddle me red. I will describe something to you without a comparison. I'll describe a car. It's a mode of transport. It has four wheels.
No. But colour is a concept. Because who can be sure that we all see colour the same?
Oh, listen to you, Buddha. And you probably could do with losing a few pounds. And the straight... Why has Buddha got such stretchy earlobes? He wasn't like the first one to have those airwaves, was he?
Because most of wisdom comes from listening.
Blowholes.
Oh.
What is it with Buddha and his tummy that if you rub it, you get money?
Does money come from?
Where does money come from?
No,
it's a concept.
No, here's money.
God is a concept by which we measure our pain. Oh. It's got heavy already. So they were trying to describe a colour,
yeah.
Right? And she's going, nah. It's more like a miserable lilac.
Oh, I know what she means. Mauve.
Really?
It's sort of sludgy.
Well, of course, it brings us into the realms of overheard conversations. And we had, who was it? Come in. You don't need to read. Colin is at the door. Can he come in?
No,
he can't.
I can see him. Look.
No, tell him he can. If he goes and stands by the window, no one is allowed in. You're allowed to speak, by the way. Don't be shy. That's a terrifying note to. No, not the bill. Not the window in the building. Oh God, what? No.
He's in.
He's in a holding area. What?
Flipping.
He's in the antechamber.
Oh, yeah. Can we turn the oxygen off in that area? What's is that possible?
What's the best signal for go away?
That one. Giving him that, I'm giving him.
Oh, look, he's doing
it. I'll
tell
you what we're going to do, right? We're going to make an exception for Colin. Normal, don't turn up, guys. You won't get in. Colin can come in for 5 minutes.
Okay.
And tell us about hashtag Fossil Friday.
If he touches me, though.
Yeah.
You've got to have him.
But play a record and we'll get him in. You need your fader up as well.
Yeah, okay.
03459 455 555. Overheard conversations. And if you want to ask any questions about fossils, well, your man is coming in. Lower the needle, because you won't have queued that up properly.
I have.
You haven't? Told you. Oh, it's coming out of one ear. Go on, you keep...
You got to bang it.
Oh, no, is it...
Right, abort, because this is coming out one-legged. Right, hang on.
Hang on a minute.
Why is that off there?
I can fix that, because I saw Kelly fix it the other day.
Yeah, she just pushed the plug in a bit harder.
Oh, flipping heck. Hang on, that means I'm kind of... okay, I'm limited by what I can play here, because I was listening to this on me in the car. It's not very good. Right, so we want this. There we go. I can do it.
Colin's in the studio.
Good morning.
Can we just ride the fader? I'm riding it. Would you ride? Well, ride it quicker than that. Ride Gene Simmons.
He's the only one who hasn't ridden
that's
Gene
from
Simmons.
The, by the way, that's... That's from the excellent, I say excellent, we're going to talk about this as well later on, Colin, you're welcome to contribute, The Greatest Moments in Rock. That's from the first Gene Simmons from Kiss solo album. You're a fan of Kiss, Colin?
No.
Oh, okay.
Huh? You surprise me.
No, I'm a real old rock and roller.
Are you?
Are you a fan of Kisses?
No.
Okay, fine, that's
good
that's,
to know.
Okay.
Not from you, anyway.
Thank you. You need to speak into the microphone.
Sorry.
Thank you very much indeed. Have you never been on radio
before? I can't see you
before?
Anymore now you're no. behind that.
You couldn't see him if he stood up.
He's only a few times.
It's Kiss were one of the biggest rock bands in America in the late 70s. Mm-hmm. They were full of ego, and half of them were full of cocaine, which makes their ego even bigger. And they wanted to release... They didn't just want to release another album, so they said, I know what, why don't we all release... a solo album, so four albums on the same day. That way, we'll all make four times as much money. Of course, it backfired, and nobody bought any of the records, and the Kiss machine started to collapse from there. Great moments in rock, please. 03459 455 555.
When Kanye West went up and said that, oh, it's not really rock, is it?
It counts. Great moments in music. We'll have that. Yeah, go
Kanye
on.
West went up, didn't he? Because someone hadn't won, and he thought they should have, and he took the thing off Taylor Swift, and that was terrible, but good.
You a fan of Kanye?
No.
What are you here for, Colin? The rules very clearly state you can't just rock up to a radio station and come on the air. And yet, strangely, that's exactly what you've done.
Well, I was looking for a rabbit hole.
Oh.
You talk to him, Cathy. Excuse me.
You told me you've been having a rummage through your jumble this morning.
Well, no, I've been rummaging through the YMCA... back office and looking for some
Colin has
rabbit
me to,
hole of memorabilia.
Colin has allowed me to slip into his back office.
At the YMCA?
Yeah, very, very much indeed.
Yes.
Is it fun to stay there?
Colin.
It also doubles up as the toilet.
Oh, handy.
that's, I know, and that's one of the reasons it puts me off the whole practice. Colin,
yes.
how are you recovering from yesterday's hashtag Fossil Friday?
All right, I had lots of retweets and favourites.
Well, you had one from me.
And a couple of others.
Oh, really?
Yes.
No one important, though, apart from me. Come on, Colin.
Natural History Museum.
Oh, those guys.
Those suckers. They don't even have a real... they don't even have real dinosaurs. They just have the nonsense. What have you got for us, Colin? You're sucking the life out of us.
Oh,
you're turning
no,
us into fossils.
Not a lot, mate.
Well,
not a lot.
Okay. Well,
it's been fun.
That's Kat's way of saying on your bike. I tell you what.
We'll have to let you go.
No.
That's what you say. That's
no,
the polite
way. I'll tell you what we can do. I've got an idea of what we can do. Where's my bag?
I don't know. You're having a rummage through mine then.
Right, Colin.
Yeah, I'm
fancy
right.
game Uno. Of Uno.
Uno.
Fancy a game of Uno.
Never played.
Now, last time I won, didn't I?
No. You've last time we nearly got stuck on a train forever because of
that time I didn't.
I'll tell you what. Play a record because right. I think I've sorted out the record player now.
We'll soon find out. Should we just?
I'll shuffle and deal, and then when you come back, we'll be playing Uno live. 03459 455 555 is the telephone number. Katherine, I'm talking until you drop the needle.
Dropped.
Okay. Fingers crossed. It's going to come out of both speakers this time. Hello. Have you put the fader up, Katherine?
It's not doing anything.
Oh, flippin' heck.
Hang on. It's going round.
Well, it's going round. Hang on. You'll put the... Hang on. You want that fader up?
It was. What if you pressed?
I think it might be broken.
Right, what if you pressed?
I think there's something going round because we've had to close the shop because...
Is it because you've got that stuck in there?
No. It's got nothing to do with that. Hang on. God, I don't know what's going on. Colin, do you know how to fix a radio?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
Should I talk to Paul while you're doing that?
You talk to Paul, I'll fix the record player.
So Paul is on which one? On fader 3, is that C?
Yeah, no, you idiot, it's that one. It's that one there.
Hiya, Paul.
Hiya, how you doing?
Terribly. It's going exactly as we thought it would.
Oh, Paul, we haven't got a copy of the Daily Star. He wants to know if his text was in the Daily Star.
No, I told
it's
you.
It's not in there today. It's not in there. I'll check myself. I'm gutted.
Now, you're new to me, Paul, because you're one from WM, aren't you?
That's correct, mate. Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah.
Well, it's nice to hear your tones, your dulcets.
Yeah, no, I spoke to you on Twitter this morning, so I just thought I'd say hello.
Oh, well, hello, Paul. What are you up to today?
Hello, Catherine. I'm actually going to the football today, but I thought I'd give Iain a call before I go to the pub.
Because he loves the football. He loves it.
And he doesn't like football. And it's my son's birthday. My son's fourth birthday.
Well done.
How old is he?
Yes, he's four.
Right.
You spoke to him before, Iain, on the trampoline he was.
Oh, yeah, I remember. Yeah, he's a good lad. Yeah, bouncy.
He's in the living room with me mum.
Is he?
Yeah.
Why is your mum in the living room?
She's sitting down watching the telly.
What's on? Anything good? Am I missing anything?
No, just the football. No, just the football. Yeah. Are we on there, by the way?
Yeah, we are. Can't you tell?
Are we on there?
Can't you tell? It feels special, doesn't it? Feels very special. Do you want to speak to Colin? He's here too. Colin, say hello to Paul.
Hello, Paul.
How are you doing, Colin?
Put your headphones.
Oh, flipping it. Right, this is all going terrible.
One of the greatest.
I believe the phrase is it's all gone tits up. Are we allowed to say that?
Yes. Here we go.
One of the greatest moments.
Oh, yes, I can hear you now, Paul.
Excellent. Hello. Talk to Paul.
Hi, Colin. How are you, my friend?
Not too bad. It's been one of those
days. Well, what have you been up to, mate?
Oh, well, I had my flu jab at 9 o'clock.
Oh, yeah, that's Tony. Does it hurt?
Then I went along to the YMCA show.
Right, guys, this is the most boring. Right, can we, I tell you what I'm going to do, right? Colin, get out. Paul, go away.
He invites you in.
You just rocked up. We specifically said you can't come in.
No, you did not. Oh,
what the hell is going on? Give us one fossil fact, then flip off.
One fossil fact.
Yes.
It takes 30 meters of.
Where's this going?
Wood to make 1 meter of coal.
Gosh, that's a good one.
Bye, Paul.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Hey, that's a quick fade, that.
Yeah, that's it. Well done. Well done. We're learning.
Right, we're on.
Can we just say, you can't
call
just...
Me. And can't so just... Lino on the text, stop telling everyone they can, you stirrer. I know exactly what's going on there.
And yeah, we know the music's all right. I think I fixed the record player.
Yeah, could you hear it wibbling about? Because that was Iain waddling the lead.
I would suggest other great moments in rock. the John Lennon bedding. I love the John Lennon bedding. I love the bedding. I love the bedding. You wouldn't get a pop star now that would expose themselves.
You would. Kanye and Kim. I'm surprised they've not done it yet.
Well, but the pop stars... Back then, we didn't have the Heat magazine, okay? And we didn't know anything about pop stars or movie stars. They were enigmas. Now, you know, you can watch everybody do a Periscope and a tweet and all that kind of stuff. You know, we know everything about everybody.
Too much, I think.
Too much information. I've got really bad indigestion. I had a big bag of those Twix.
Yeah, thanks for saving me one.
Absolute pleasure.
Didn't save me any.
We know too much about all of our celebrities and pop stars at the moment. But John Lennon, say, hey, guys, me and my wife are going to be in bed in Amsterdam. Come and have some of that. I bet it was dirty.
But it stank.
You know when...
You only need to crack a window. That.
Yeah, and also, if you even have one round of toast in bed, you've got crumbs in there for the next week. It's disgusting.
Plus, it was, what, the 70s? Very hairy.
Very, I believe it would be 1969.
Wow.
Go on then, do something.
I think I need to hit a trail and I've not done it.
Go on then.
All right, B. Hang on, I'm concentrating.
You twit.
Every weekday morning.
Good morning, Jonathan.
Morning. Do you think it's right to tell 1 million disabled people they should get off benefits and find a job?
Have your say on today's big phone-in.
People who are going to be a nuisance are going to be a nuisance regardless of whether they're a thing to do.
Is it true that people over the age of 65 drink far too much booze?
The JVS Show fights for your rights and tackles your consumer problems.
Waited and the receipt came out. But the cash didn't.
It's become a problem of late because obviously the trees got bigger as we got here.
We couldn't shut the French windows. It would appear that they'd buckled.
I had a phone call from my daughter saying, if we don't get off the train, they're going to hand us over to the British Transport Police.
The JVS Show, weekdays from 9 on BBC Three Counties Radio. Local and vocal across Beds, Hearts and Bucks.
This is Iain Lee.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
We're hanging out on facebook.com/radiorabbithole.
Oh, yeah, I better get that up.
And James is writing, when something's so ropey, it's good.
I hope you feel that way.
Listen, the way I see the show... Yeah, and by the way, you call in, you need to make it so you can see phone books, because call in... Anytime you want, about anything you want. You know, we're just going to sit here kind of chatting.
Yeah.
But you can call in about anything you want. 03459 455 555. It's going to evolve as the weeks progress. That's kind of the plan.
Should we see what Russell wants?
Oh.
Morning, Russell.
Hello there.
Hello.
It's afternoon, by the way. You're used to mornings.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
I was just going to say, this really isn't going well, is it?
Well, no. What's your definition of not going well?
My
bank account is getting more money in. So that's partly is a plus.
That's good. You've got that one. Yeah, you've got that one.
Yeah.
Anyway, this is not going brilliantly, but you're persevering. That's good. I suppose you've got to fill the time.
Russell, have you got anything positive or nice to say? Or you just want to come on and be snarky?
I was going to join in. And,
go on, join in.
Yeah, just,
join
just in, overheard conversations.
Yeah, yeah, go on.
At the football this morning, children's, under nines, girls, brilliant, friendly.
Yes.
7-2 was the final score. Anyway,
7-2? I mean, I don't know anything about football, or girls, for those things. But I do know a little bit about under nines. I have two of them. Yeah. But 7-2 seems like a massive...
It's a resounding thrashing.
For kids, when the score is that much of a difference, do they kind of... Do the grown-ups kind of step in a bit to stop it getting any more humiliating?
There's a thing in the paper, have you seen?
No.
About apparently the junior leagues are going to stop publicising drubbins like that because it doesn't do anyone any favours.
So you've just crushed 11 9-year-old girls.
Well, no, there was only 5 aside, so
in that case,
of them that have gone home broken and ruined their weekend. Yeah, it's a price they must pay. But anyway, listening to the type of people that are bringing these kids to the games, the dads chatting away in the corner, listening to them, and they're talking about how to dodge full CFA payments, talking about using wage slips that are old and haven't got full amounts of money on, and things
like
that.
That's how you do it. That's how you do it.
That was what I overheard, and I was thinking, wow, and... These people are bringing up children to act like that.
You've reminded me. I'm a child that was brought up, and now I have to assume the responsibility of the grown-up. I'm supposedly supposed to have sorted out my mum's pension, right?
Oh.
That would have kicked in yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Was she looking forward to that?
She was looking forward to it. Spends, isn't it? I went to the care home where she's at, and I was going through her mail, and there was a letter dated August the 14th saying, yeah, we haven't got all the documents, so you can't have your pension. I'm thinking, oh, flip it. Guess, here are the documents I've got to find for my mum. It's like blooming Treasure Quest, right? And tell me, Russ, where I'm going to find these. I've got to find my mum's birth certificate.
Oh, it'll be in a shoebox.
You can go and buy a new one.
From where?
From the register office.
All right, nice one. And her marriage licence.
Same again.
You're joking.
Nope, serious, mate. Get yourself to the register office. But, they will sort it all out.
But what do I need to know to get that? I don't know. I don't know when she was married.
Her name and date of birth.
Wowzers. And that will give me all the information I require?
That would do it. That would do it. And you must ensure that you refer to it as a register office and not a registry office, because that is wrong.
What, and they'll laugh him out of there?
Now, hang on. Which one is right and which one is wrong? And I'm going to say the opposite of what you say,
register
because...
Register is right.
Registrar.
Register office. Where they keep the registers, not but where they keep the registries.
What about the registrars?
That's a job title. That is correct.
That's okay.
Speak to a registrar at the register office.
Okay. Top tips. Thank you very much, Russell.
There we go. 03459-455-555 is the telephone number if you want to give us a call.
You can do. You can do. And if you've been to the registry office lately... I hope
imagine,
it was good.
Imagine the sinking feeling I felt in my heart when I looked at a letter that said, oh, yeah, your pension is not happening because you've not filled in these forms. I filled in the forms. And we need your marriage licence. Flipping heck. I should have asked him, where is there a registrar office? Because I don't even know...
You have to go to the one where she got married, don't you?
That'll be the council, will it?
Yeah, I should think so.
OK. I'm keeping half an eye out, because I've got no idea if we've got travel or anything happening in the show.
No, Russell was on Fader 3, and now know he's gone.
OK, well, then that's all we need to know. That's all
we
need to know.
Do you want me to read some texts? They're all quite nice, but one's mean. From Marion and Hemel, is Colin a fossil because he sounds like one? Now, come on.
Come on now. Hey, this is good. If you've ever decorated your pet, 03459-455-555. I tell you why. You know the Dartmoor ponies?
Yeah.
They're weird. Right. If you go to Dartmoor in the New Forest and stuff, it's full of ponies.
They think they own the place.
Well, they do. They're everywhere. But who owns the Dartmoor ponies?
The Queen.
Okay, yeah, I'll give you that. She owns all the swans in the country, doesn't she?
Yeah. So she can eat them if she wants.
She can do. Can she eat a pony?
I think she can do pretty much as she pleases.
OK, well, the Dartmoor ponies will be painted with a reflective blue stripe to help drivers spot them. Well, 60 have been killed in crashes this year. Imagine hitting a pony.
You'd know about
it. You would know about that. I saw a dead deer today.
A little one or a big one?
It was... here we go, guys. It was hard to tell.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, I know exactly. We got a dog, as you know. I'm not a fan of dogs. And I'm really thinking I've made a terrible mistake getting a dog. But the highlights that my family are looking forward to are Christmas, when we can put hats on it and cardigans and things like that.
A jumper. I think a Christmas jumper looks festive.
Yeah, something like that. And I don't quite... I'm never quite bought into the decorating animals, but...
I think it's a bit cruel.
Well... 03459-455-555.
But she'll soon let you know if she doesn't like it.
Go on, we go in the papers and I'll put a song on.
Well, not an awful lot. I saw that thing about the kids and the not telling people that your kid's been thrashed 15-0 in a weekend football. Oh, this. It's already started. It's only October. Page 18 of the Daily Express. Campaigners were celebrating yesterday after a council dumped its Winterfest and brought back Christmas. The Labour-run city council in Stoke-on-Trent was bombarded with complaints last year after banning any reference to Christmas for fear of upsetting other religions, says the Express. Now under no overall control, the council's rebranded this year's street festivities Love Christmas.
Yeah.
That's an order. Delighted, Simon Calvert of the Christian Institute said, "It's a victory for common sense. The vast majority of people of all religions or none love Christmas. Councils that abolish it just make themselves look ridiculous." So, good news if you're in Stoke.
I don't think it's never been abolished, though, has it? No. That's the whole myth about abolishing Christmas. 034, we're going to play a song. They've got a record queued up, so put up the grey fader. 03459-455-555 is the telephone number if you want to give us a call. Keep trying. Listen, I don't know what I'm doing. Kath don't know
what she's doing.
Jess on the phone doesn't know. None of us know what we're doing. If you call up, you will get on the air. Let's have a little bit of Doctor Hook. Lower that. You can text as well, 81333. Start your text, 3CR.
That's all right, isn't it? That's Dr. Hook.
You can't go wrong with a little bit of Dr. I love Dr. We're going to get Dennis on. He's off to Dennis, the voice of Dr. Hook. Not the eye patch, the actual singer of Dr. Hook.
Who is a lovely fella.
He's such a nice bloke. He's off to Australia, and he's going to come, when he comes back, he's going to come on the show. But the guy with the eye patch wasn't the singer with the band, right?
Oh.
But in America, he tours as Dr. Hook. So everyone goes and they go, oh, look, it's Dr. Hook. He's got the hat and the eye patch on. And then he starts to sing and they go, oh, flip, his voice hasn't lasted. He's not the same fella. That's why his voice hasn't lasted as well, because he's not the same fella.
So the only reason they only realise they've been diddled when the he starts.
I don't think he's diddling them. There's no diddling. It's not the 1970s.
Hiya, Kyle.
Hi, Car.
How are you? You're right.
Yeah, I'm not bad. It's very strange to be ringing you from Rochdale and not London.
It is very strange.
It's not strange for us.
Well, Rochdale's strange. Have you been?
Makes no difference to us. Oh. We're in the same place that we would receive the phone call. So as the receivers, which is a great name for a band, by the way, guys. For the receivers, it makes no difference whatsoever. For the caller, yeah, maybe.
What are you doing in Rochdale anyway? What on earth are you doing in Rochdale?
Well, I'm better live here. I'm back home.
Oh, I forgot you're an import, aren't you?
Yeah. And then normally, when I ring in during the week, I'm normally hiding somewhere in London when I ring in.
Gosh.
All the three counties. So,
well,
so yeah, no, I'm just loving the show. I think it's really good.
How can you? It's the show that only a mother could love. And I am a mother and I'm not loving it.
It's brilliant. It's educational. It's taught me a lot about radio.
Well, and what exactly has it taught you about radio?
It's taught me about the importance of faders and making sure the stereo comes out the right side.
Oh, no, that's all about wiggling the leads.
Yeah, I was...
Oh, no,
it was like being at home with my kids... I was trying to think of... I can't say that or that. Messing around with my stereo equipment. I went through four words that I couldn't say, beginning with F, T, B, and another F.
We know what that means. You're evolving. You might have just said them once upon a time.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am what can only be described as evolving and revolving at 9 million miles an hour.
So what's on today, Kyle? What are you going to be doing? Anything interesting or just this?
Probably just this. I need to go to a wedding reception tonight.
Sweet.
But the reason I was ringing was the bit about when you were saying about decorating animals.
Oh, yeah. Go on. They're going to paint the Dartmoor ponies fluorescent blue. That's actually going to happen.
But that's for their own good. It's not just for fun.
Well, but it will be fun. Of course, the most famous of decorated animals. Do you see if you get this reference, Kyle? And it's not racist, but it sounds racist. Birdie num-nums.
I have no idea.
Wow, really, Katherine? I'm going to look at you. Birdie num-nums.
No, saying it again doesn't make any difference.
You don't get the reference. Nope. Wow. 03459 455 555 birdie num-nums. It's the most famous example of a decorated animal I can think of. Anyway, Carl, continuez-vous, s'il vous plaît?
It's my friend Anthony, the clerk of old kid, who does live in that London. He doesn't want to decorate an animal, but he does want to, like, make loads of money and dress up like a chimp or a small monkey in, like, a little butler's outfit and have it serve drinks to him.
Who doesn't want that, frankly? That's a party.
He's actually... Hang on a minute. Who's dressed up as a monkey in this scenario?
He wants... No. It's not what you're saying, is it, Kyle?
No. My friend Anthony wants a little... Is it a macaco?
Yeah, a macaque.
A macaque your pants.
Don't be afraid to say it, yeah.
They smear that stuff all over the shop.
But they fling it about. But, yeah, he wants to get one of those dressed up as a butler and have it serving drinks to him.
Well... I think that might backfire quite badly.
In Camden, in North London, if you've ever been to London, then you may have heard of Camden. Even if you've not been to London, you may have heard of Camden. There is, I don't know what the shop is now, but it used to be a Victorian pet shop, and it's still got the Victorian frontage atop of it. And it says, we sell rare parrots and monkeys. And imagine, you know, in Victorian times, you would have gone into a pet shop and there would have been just a row of monkeys in cages. It really doesn't get any more beautiful than that, does it?
I would love a monkey, but it never ends well, does it? In the stories I've heard about people keeping monkeys.
Do they not get a bit older and then they get a bit nasty?
They get nasty and, to be honest, they get a little bit, you know... Let's just say adult.
Well, when I took a former girlfriend of mine to Monkey World in Poole, I think it is, Dorset, somewhere in Dorset. It's a brilliant place, one of my favourite places in the world. We saw We saw a monkey. A monkey was just sat there looking at people. My girlfriend walked past. He started pleasuring himself. And I just... that's a true story, guys. That's a true story.
So tell the Clerkenwell kid about that. You might have to rethink his butler assignment.
I will do.
Thank you, Kyle. See you later.
See you, Kyle. Let's talk to Mark's in Coventry. Hello, Mark.
Hello. Hello, you all right?
Yeah. What are you doing in Coventry?
I'm listening to your show.
Well, yeah, stupid question. Fair enough. What have you got for us, Mark?
I'm sat at home today like I do every Saturday and helping my lad with his maths homework, and it drives me crazy. So I'm just wondering if any of your audience can give us a hand.
I like the way you've swerved us and gone straight for the audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 12:39 on Saturday, October the 3rd, the Down the Rabbit Hole show kicked off. We are. This is exactly what this is. How old's your lad?
He's 10.
Ooh, this is going to be like proper top stuff.
Right,
then.
Hang on. I'm going to have to work this out with a pencil.
Punchline to one of my favourite jokes, by the way, guys.
Go on, Mark, here's with it.
Use your finger like everyone else is another. Go on, then, what you got? Go on, let's do it.
Okay, we've got Jack's book.
What?
The pages of Jack's book are numbered from 1.
Yeah, they would be. They generally
are. The page numbers have a total of 555 digits.
Yes.
Oh, no.
How many pages has the book?
Hang on a minute. Say that. Whoa, dude. Hang on a second. So it was a.
I know it's too much, isn't it?
Say it again.
Okay, the pages of Jack's book are numbered from 1.
Yep.
The page numbers have a total of 555 digits.
What?
How many pages has the book?
555, isn't it?
No. Because I'd imagine one page is like 1, another page is 12, another page.
So you've got to add up all the digits?
Yeah.
200. It's got 236.
Is that right?
Yeah, that is actually right.
No, okay, I'm suspicious.
You can write to
No, don't.
No, put it down in your book.
How do you know this?
Well, because you're adding up all the digits as you go along, so you just divide it, and then you get 236.
You reckon?
Yeah, I do. Well,
this is his kid's future.
It's his own.
I'm not that convinced by the answer.
Why would you not believe me, for crying out loud? Why on earth would you not believe me?
It was too quick.
Exactly.
It would really take me 10 minutes. The 20 minutes.
It sounded like he was making it up to me as well. I wouldn't trust him.
I'm like the Rain Man. I can just do that stuff, for crying out loud.
Should we talk to Katia, because she might know better?
Oh, Katia will know.
You're bright.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm so excited to be talking to Kath today as a presenter.
Yeah. You should be excited.
I am.
You should be slightly worried as well.
Yes, I am.
I'm driving the desk and I haven't got a flipping clue what I'm doing.
I think you're going to be brilliant. I think you are brilliant now already.
Oh, thanks. Anyway, talk to Mark because he's doing maths and Ian's made something up and this kid's future hangs in the balance. He's going to end up working somewhere terrible at this rate because I think you're being irresponsible with your answers.
Okay, Mark.
Okay. Jack,
hello?
Page numbers. Hello, you all right?
I am.
He's talking to her. Just because she's got a foreign accent, he's talking to her like she's an imbecile.
Well. Okay, hold on a second. Are you not the guy who wanted to marry me, are you?
No, okay, I'm married. Then. My two boys are listening.
Awkward.
Okay, that's fine. That's okay. I'm relieved. That's good. Okay, carry on.
It's a bit rude, Katia. Why are you relieved? He's a very nice man.
Maybe, yes. Okay, I shall think about it.
You didn't ask you, Katia. Stick to the maths.
Okay. You know the
page numbers of Jack's book are numbered from 1. The page numbers have a total of 555 digits.
Right.
How many pages has the book?
555? Book?
Yeah.
Pages. 555...
This is the sound of a woman desperately.
It's 25.
It's 25, isn't it?
You said that with the same certainty you said the first answer.
It's got to be 25.
Okay.
I wanted to wish you a happy band book week.
Hang on a minute. Can I ask?
Yeah.
He's asked us the wrong question.
Yeah.
I haven't.
Have you got the question in front of you?
I have.
Read it from the book, because you've just asked us the wrong question.
Are you Googling?
Okay, here we go. The pages of Jack's book are numbered from one.
Yeah, listen.
The page numbers have a total of 555 digits.
That's not the question.
It is. How many pages has the book?
No, the because I've Googled this question, right? And the question I've got in front of me is the pages of Jack's book are numbered from one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The pages have 555 digits.
The page numbers have a total of 555.
This is what I'm reading.
This teacher's freestyling.
The pages have 555 digits. How many of the digits are a five?
That's the second question.
Man!
If your kid can answer the first one, they can move on and get an extra star.
Oh, flipping heck. I'm actually feeling nauseous. Katya, have you got the answer?
Five.
No, it's got to be 25.
Why? Why?
Well, because it's maths. And maths is
Imagine
science.
What this is like every Saturday with my little lad, and all I want to do is chill out.
He's 10. Is he like Stephen Hawking or something? Is he like some super genius?
Hang on a minute. Do you know what we need here? We need a proper dad. I've got one here. Wilson's dad. Hello, Wilson's dad.
Afternoon.
This guy's a genius. This guy knows about video games. He makes a podcast. He's a free thinker. He'll do it. Wilson's dad, answer this man's question.
What's the question?
Okay.
Pages of Jack's book are numbered from one. The page numbers have a total of 555 digits. How many pages has the book?
555 digits.
Yep.
Don't know.
Wilson's dad.
It's Saturday. I can't do numbers on Saturdays. Hang on. How many of the digits are a five?
No, that's the second question.
That's the second question. Yeah,
yeah. Stick to the first question and stop trying to deviate.
Oh, okay. 221 pages.
Now
you don't know this, you're making it up.
Right, I'll tell you what we're going to do. Ladies and gentlemen, Katya?
Yeah?
Quickly, make your point. What was the point you wanted to make?
I wanted to know what you...
Brilliant.
Very interesting.
Thanks very much indeed.
And that's the song.
No, it's not. Put it back up. Turn our mics off. Enjoy.
Every weekday from 3.
It's not just about what we bring you.
Starting off on the M25, it's particularly heavy moving anti-clockwise.
It's also about what you bring us.
In the end, I could only eat off my ironing board.
Your stories.
Every room in the house was just... I was climbing over mountains of rubbish.
Your humour.
There's a reason why you earn the big bucks, you see. That sort of insightful comment is exactly right.
Your opinions.
Well, the culture's got to change because the police can't do it and the traffic wardens are so busy. So the culture has to change.
I think parents do change into different human beings when they are picking their kids up.
Roberto Peroni.
And everyone across Beds, Hearts and Bucks.
Weekdays from 3 on BBC Three Counties Radio.
Across Beds, Hearts and Bucks.
Katherine Boyle and Iain Lee.
On BBC Three Counties Radio.
That maths question, seriously, my mind just goes blank.
Here's the thing, young 10-year-old. You don't need to know that. My life has not been... Well, maybe my life has been stunted because I don't know that. I think it's 25. Because you just keep adding it up to get to 555.
You reckon?
03459, 455, 595.
So let's see if Joey in London's got anything sensible to contribute. Hello, Joey. Joe.
Hello.
Hello, Joe. Sorry, I've been overfamiliar there. What did you want to say?
I wanted to say the previous caller's question reminded me of a fact I heard drunk a couple of nights ago. Did you know that all the numbers on a roulette board add up to 666?
No.
Devil's game or something? So what I wanted to do was then work that back. So I took the 666, took 36 off, then took 35 off, then took 34 off, yeah. Which gives you 561. But, so my answer was going to be 34. But, of course, none of this makes any sense because it doesn't end up being 555, which isn't divisible with the method that I use. And it's pretty much it.
Hang on a minute. Were you using the method of a roulette table to try and do that young man's homework?
Exactly, because they all add up. 0 to 36 add up to 666.
But what's that got to do with Jack's book?
Well, I tried to work it back, and then it might have been the pages might have been 34. So if you add up 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4.
Yeah, I who is this Jack anyway in his smug little book? How did you know that about the roulette table?
I got told it by a friend, actually, and it really stuck with me. It's really odd.
You ever played roulette?
Yes.
You're a fan of it?
Not really. There's no skill. It's all luck. I like a game with some skill.
First time I went to a casino, my mate Paul, I can't remember his name.
What are you miming Paul for?
I'm miming snooker because he's got a snooker table.
Paul the snooker.
Paul Garner. And he took me and my then girlfriends to a casino and we all dressed up and we had a little bit of layout doing like Chinese food and all this stuff. I won enough money on my first ever time playing roulette to take me and my then girlfriend to Prague on holiday and stay in a swanky hotel.
Gosh.
I won a fortune.
That's impressive.
It's impressive. And I just kept doubling up. Red or black. That's all you've got to do. Red or black, you double up. Don't worry about the numbers. The number, you're never going to get a number. The chances...
Are you telling people the secret to winning at the casino?
Yeah.
I'm not sure we can do that.
It's the equivalent of counting cards. You just keep doubling up. Just keep red or black. And what you do is, because it tells you... It's foolproof, this method. Your foolproof gambling methods, by the way. We'll take those. It's foolproof. It tells you... So if you see, like, a table, there's loads of different tables, and if you see a table that's had 7 blacks in a row, I'll put 50 quid on... or it wasn't even putting that. I'll put 20 quid down on it being red. And if it didn't come up red then, I'll put 40 quid down. If it didn't come up red then, I'll put 60 quid. It'll come up, you win!
Could have been so different.
No, that's a common misnomer, I'm afraid.
Excuse me?
It's called Martingale, what you're talking about. And what will happen is...
Martingale.
Right. Martingale. What will happen is the casino will cap the maximum that you're allowed to bet. So let's say you start with 40. It's come in 10 red, for instance. You start with 40 quid. It doesn't come in on the 11th time, so you have to double up to 80. But that's just to get your money back. So really what you have to do is put, like, 85 on. Of course, if that doesn't come in now, you've got compound losses of, like, 125. Wow. You now need to back 150. And what the casino will do is, once you get to sort of 9 grand or something, is they will say, sorry, you can't bet anymore anyway. And who's to say it couldn't come in 50 times red or 50 times
black? And fair play to what he's saying, actually, guys. I said it was foolproof. Every other time I've tried it since then, I've lost significant amounts of cash.
Good caveat.
And so, the truth will set you free.
thank you, brother. You know, just a day at a time. Thank you very much for that. He makes an excellent...
Give you one other anecdote, Iain.
Of course you can, boss.
It's the only reason I even know who you are, to be honest. You used to be on Big Breakfast about 10 years ago. I remember getting ready for college or something. Oh. I'm 29 now.
Oh, you're a boy, 18, yeah.
19. Yeah. Hopefully the maths works out, and that was when you were on Big Breakfast.
Well,
anyway,
it was Rise, but yeah, it was we followed the Big Breakfast. Yeah, go on.
You and someone else were interviewing someone who was incredibly sort of dry and robotic, and they were giving you nothing to work with. And at the end of it, you slyly got in the phrase syntax error, which I thought was hilarious. And I've used it any time I've had any sort
for
of
those,
kind of
for those who don't know, dry. Syntax error is if you were a pro, you're too young to know that. Surely, if you had a home computer in the 80s and you were to type your own programs, like 10 print Iain is skills, 20 go to 10. if you wrote a program that didn't work or typed in something that didn't work, it would say syntax error. Mm-hmm. Basically, it means, you know, your computer, your robot ain't doing what it's supposed to do.
Exactly.
And, who was it that I was implying was a soulless droid?
I can't remember. It was, I don't know, it was the era of MS-DOS. And I know what MS-DOS is. I didn't know the that original story
well,
behind it.
Do you know what?
Syntax.
If you keep listening throughout this week, and I'll try and drop a syntax error
yeah,
into
we'll
conversation.
We'll definitely get one. Well,
really should, because then I started following you on Twitter, which is why I knew you had this show coming on, and then I've just been cleaning the flat all morning, put it on. It's really good. It's been a shambles,
yeah.
A really enjoyable shambles.
Bless you, brother. Thank you very much
Thank
indeed.
You,
and it has been a shambles. Listen, the reason it's a shambles is because we don't know, you know, Katherine produces the show, and we don't co-host a show, so we're kind of learning each other's rhythms. You're driving the desk because you're filling in for me for a couple of days in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
So you need to learn this very user-unfriendly desk. And also,
I've got really short arms as well, and it's quite far apart. So
you like T-Rex. we don't know what the show is. The show is kind of determined by you. We're getting loads of calls, which is awesome.
Yeah.
Keep calling. You will get through. It's Jess who's taking the phone calls, and she will get you through at some point. 03459 455 555. Have we got any more?
Yeah, we've got loads.
Record?
We've got loads. Let's talk to Tony. Morning, Tony. Afternoon,
hi,
sorry.
Catherine.
Hiya. What have you got for us?
Afternoon. Well, I've got a foolproof method of winning a three-car brag.
You reckon? Okay, go on.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I've won loads at it. It's a bit like card counting, but you can actually stack the hand that you want to receive six hands before, as long as you're dealing. So when you collect the cards, you actually stack them into the hand that you want to receive, and then when another six hands comes around again, or six deals come around again, that's the ones you get. And especially if you go blind on that hand, you know, which means that you bet without seeing your cards, you can win staggering amounts. But it is cheating, so effectively it's cheating.
So your turn is out to cheat. How do you feel about that as a person, Paul, who's listening on the other line?
I wouldn't cheat.
No,
never.
You would,
never, 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 never.
No, not even at three-card brag.
Oh, I don't know what two-card brag is.
No, I don't
like
either.
Pontoon?
I was just nodding and smiling all
is
the way through
like
there.
Is it like cribbage?
Hang on, Tony.
No.
Is it like cribbage?
No, it's like poker, but with only three cards.
Okay. The poker sounds like I'll be honest, the dullest card game. I've got Uno in front of me, which is a great card game.
It's the best card game ever.
But poker is... And also, because if you say, do you fancy a game of poker? Then which one do you want? Seven card stud? Do you want a hard hot willy? Do you want a Texas Brag'em? What do those things even mean?
A what?
I don't know. It's five card draw for me. Have you ever played it?
No, I haven't. No, I haven't.
Oh, well, you should try it.
Okay. Top tip. Thank you very much. Let's go to Paul. What did you call in about maths, I hear?
Well, it was going to be about the question about poor old Jack and his book.
Oh, that flipping book.
That's it. I mean, the 1 + 2 + 3 is what I thought it would be up until it added up to 555. But apparently, the betting roulette person said that doesn't work. Also, when it said 555 digits, I was going, well, 1 is 1 digit, like 12 is 2 digits, 100 is 3 digits, 555 would be like millions and trillions and billions and gazillions of digits. So, yeah, I have no idea what the answer would be, to be perfectly honest.
Well, thank you for coming on and just twisting my melon for the last 2 minutes.
Hey, that sounds pretty fun.
Good to speak to you. Right, I believe we've got travel now, so I'm going to hit this button.
Hit the button. Let's have a little bit of the trav.
Travel news for Beds, cards and bugs.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
Well, the anti-clockwise M25 is building up between Junction 17 at Maple Cross and Junction 16 for the M40. We're getting reports of Lee Grave Road in Luton blocked in both directions because of an accident. In fact, all approaches to that junction being blocked as well, so be aware of that if you're heading in that direction. The A411 Lower High Street in Watford is queuing at Bushy Arches, and there's roadworks on the M1 closing a lane between Junction 12 at Flitwick and Junction 11 for Dunstable Road. The A404 Amersham Road, there's roadworks there at Lodge Lane, and in Hartford, Port Hill is closed for gas main works at Warren Park Road. No reported delays on public transport at the moment. Martin Rothwell, BBC Three Counties Radio.
Thank you, Martin.
No.
I'm doing it completely wrong.
Okay, keep riding. Keep the bed up. Don't worry. Keep the bed. There we go. That's
right.
It.
Yeah.
You talk, and then at 59:27, right. You hit the other button.
So I'm going to keep talking for now until in about 20. Right. So anyway, we're doing all kinds of stuff this morning. We've got an hour left down the rabbit hole with me and Iain Lee. Iain Lee standing in the corner, shaking his head and looking for the exit. And you could phone us about anything. 03459 455 555.
Vocal across Beds, Hearts and Bucks.
This is BBC Three Counties Radio.
It's 1 o'clock. I'm Louise Parry. The headlines: aid agency condemns Afghan hospital bombing, air crash in Essex and ram raid attempt in Biggleswade.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
The international aid charity MSF has condemned the bombing of a hospital it runs in the Afghan city of Kunduz, in which 9 members of staff were killed. The charity says Washington and Kabul were told the hospital's location, but that air attacks had continued. The American military says it might have been responsible for the airstrike. A spokesman for the Afghan Interior Ministry, Sadiq Sadiq, says terrorists were found in the hospital.
10 to 15 terrorists were hiding in the hospital last night, and they came under attack. Well, they are killed. All of the terrorists were killed, but we also lost doctors.
A light aircraft has crashed in Essex. Police ambulances and the Hertfordshire Air Ambulance are attending the scene in Chigwell. It's not known how many were on board the plane, which came down just before 10:30 this morning. Passengers on the West Coast Main Line will be automatically compensated if they face delays of more than half an hour. Virgin is the first train company in the UK to introduce the system. Vicky Hood from Virgin Trains explains how it works.
If you book your ticket through our website or through our app, then you unfortunately experience delays on your services or it's cancelled, rather than having to go through the normal process of applying for a delay repay payment, it's called, where you would have to write in and then you would receive vouchers. Instead, we will just automatically refund the appropriate amount back into your bank account or onto the card that you paid with.
There's been an attempted ram raid at a Biggleswade supermarket this morning. Police believe a stolen vehicle was used to damage the outer wall of Morrison's in Market Square shortly before 4 a.m. The raiders made off without the cash machine and the vehicle was left at the scene. Bedfordshire police say a number of large agricultural vehicles have been stolen from the county and nearby regions recently, and they're advising local businesses to stay alert. At the Rugby World Cup, England need to beat Australia at Twickenham, or their World Cup will be over in just 3 matches. This afternoon, Scotland play South Africa in Newcastle. That match kicks off at 4:45. Meanwhile, Stadium MK hosts its second of 3 matches when Japan plays Samoa at 2:30. Some residents in the Bean Hill area are unhappy about road closures, but Milton Keynes Mayor Keith McLean says he's had an overwhelmingly positive response.
I've got no detailed information about the road closures in any part of Milton Keynes, but all I know is on Thursday I had many positive reports from people getting to and from the ground. It's a big match for Milton Keynes. It will have some impact somewhere. Apologies if it's upset the gentleman.
And in football in the Premier League today, Watford go to Bournemouth. Elsewhere, Manchester City take on Newcastle, and this evening Chelsea host Southampton. The weather for Beds, Hearts and Bucks, a mix of cloud and sunshine with light winds and a high of 16 Celsius, that's 61 Fahrenheit. Get the latest news and sport online at bbc.co.uk/threecounties.
On FM, AM, online and digital radio.
Iain Lee and Katherine Boyle.
On BBC Three Counties Radio.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Turtles. I mean, really, just one of the best and most underrated bands of all time. Mark Volman from the Turtles, not very well. He's having chemo, so do you know what? I'm kind of... We're going to have at least one Turtle song every week until Mark gets better, sir. Oh, yes, sir! Afternoon. It's Iain Lee, Katherine Boyle, down the rabbit hole. It's a brand new... It's kind of evolving, you know. It's going to be a little bit of a shambles, partly because we've had terrible problems with the record player and all of that stuff, but it's going to evolve.
Partly because that's what we're like.
That's also... It's, I mean, this is probably as good as it's going to get if I'm completely blunt with you. Now, we had a... We're talking about the greatest moments in rock and roll, decorating your animals, surefire cheats at cards and other gambling techniques. And also there was, there was that question, wasn't there, about the... But Paul?
Yes.
Oh, Paul sounds like a science man.
Serious man.
Do you even remember what the question was?
Vaguely.
OK, can you remind those listeners what have just tuned in what that question was that we're trying... This is a 10-year-old's maths homework, guys.
Let me see. There's a book with 555 digits in total for the page numbers.
Yeah.
Beginning at one.
Yes.
Jack's book. Don't forget that. Jack's book.
Oh, Jack.
Jack's going to get a kicking. Sorry, Jack. Jack is going to get a right old kicking.
That book's going out the window.
Yes. Followed by Jack. Don't, because a teacher got done for that this week, chucking a book and a child out of a window. Oh, no, she hit a child with a book and threw a phone out of a window. That was it. Sorry, apologies. Apologies to all concerned there in that story.
And that was the news.
Yeah, thank you very much indeed. Coming up, sports. Yeah, Paul, go on.
Yes, yes. So, in the time I've been on hold, I've been debating, but I think...
You've been doubting yourself, yes.
I think the answer is 222 pages.
What makes you say that?
Well, it's based on the logic that numeral digits between 1 and 9 have one digit in them, and between 10 and 99 they have 2.
Yeah.
And between 100
oh, flipping
and 222,
yes,
they have 3 digits. So if you multiply, if you add 9 for the digits from 1 to 9, 178 for the digits between 10 and 99.
Anybody has a clue what's going on
I
here?
I think he's right just because of how he talks.
What do you do for a living, Paul?
Doctor.
I'm a musician.
Oh, hang on a minute.
He ain't got a clue. He sat there probably smoking a giant roll-up listening to Zappa and Beefheart.
I count bars for a living.
You do what, sorry?
I count bars rest for a living.
Oh, that's true, actually. They're good. It's a fair play. I take everything I've said about musicians back. They're excellent at counting in their heads.
So it's a percussionist.
I'm even better at
numbers. Is this Paul?
It's Paul.
Is it Paul? I hang on a minute. When did you... Paul used to live in... Where was it? Morocco?
Malaysia.
There we go. I knew it was a place that began with M and was foreign. Paul, it's lovely to see you. Speak to you. When the hell did you get... When did you get back from... where was it? Mexico?
Martinique.
Well, I was in Mexico, actually, last year. So that's a different story.
Well, but Paul, I believe... If I'm remembering the right chap, in your Facebook photos, Paul, you wear glasses, don't you?
I do, yeah.
There we go, you see. He knows the answers.
Paul with the glasses. Clever Paul. Math Paul.
Oh, in that case, it must be right.
Yeah, I think it's 222.
All right, listen.
So do I, because you said it.
Paul, thank you very much indeed. 03459 455 555. I'm hesitating. I'm going to say Peter.
Peter.
Ah, you idiot!
You stuffed the whole show up!
Balls. Catherine, talk to Petra, but let's see what she... She needs the woman's touch, and Catherine's here to give
that.
The woman's touch.
Hello, Petra. Brace yourself.
Hi. I make it 264, working on a similar principle.
Oh, hang on a second. Paul in Leeds, you still there?
I'm still there.
Right, she's got... how many did you say?
222.
I said 222.
Right, and you said what, Petra?
264.
Right, go on then, sort it out. Which one's right?
Sort it out.
This is a child's future at stake here. Petra, how do you get to that?
Right, 99 digits up to 100. 1 to 10 is 9, and then 10 to 100 is 90. So 99 up to 100, right?
Yeah, 10 up to 99, though.
No, it isn't.
10 to 99 have 2 digits. 100 has 3 digits.
And 1...
Fight.
Yeah, so
all those courses have been on about making radio accessible. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, 99 digits up to 100, right? And then you've got 3 digits up to 999, didn't you? But yeah. You only want 555. Yeah. So you take 99 away from... this is getting so crazy. I make it 64, and I've written it down. 125 pages I made it initially, that I handed. So I took 99 away from the 124.
This is the British version of 8 Mile. Instead of having
we're having
a maths battle.
And I think this is really sad because it's a 10-year-old child. And all of us adults can't do it.
We're all screwed. Okay. Well, hang on. Stay there, Peter.
Petter.
Yes. No. Peter.
No, Petter. She's called Petter.
No.
Petter.
No.
Petter.
No. Petter, you stay there. And hello? Paul, you stay there. Peter.
Yes.
You see where the confusion comes from now.
Yes.
Have you called in about this?
No, I called in to help you about finding things out about your mum.
Oh.
Hang on a second. Finding things out about your mum?
You said you wanted to get marriage certificates. And
we're all sweating a little bit more there.
By the way, it's a great phone-in. When have you found out things about your mum? 03459 455555.
I can tell you one.
Go on, Peter.
Right. I've been doing family history for about 10 years.
Gosh, you must be tired.
Yes. I'm very, very old.
Go on, then.
And I can explain to you how to do it.
Yes.
What you need to do is get the details of when your mum was born.
Yeah.
And a marriage.
I know the date of her birth. I've nothing. I don't know anything. I don't know where she was born. I need to get my mum's birth certificate and her wedding licence. I know the date she was born. I don't know where. London. I've got no idea when they got married. I mean, I know it was just after my just before my sister was born. It was one of them. You could hear the sounds of the shotguns being prepared.
Do you know your mum's maiden name?
I do. Yes.
Right. Well, it'll take a few minutes to explain it on air. If you want to contact me after the show, I can go through it with you.
Peter, that's very kind. That's very kind. I won't do that, but thank you.
Nice offer.
Peter, I appreciate your help. Thank you. Petter?
Yes?
You're fired. Paul?
Yes.
You're fired. Okay. We'll see if anyone agrees with you two. So Petter's saying 222. Paul's saying 264.
No, all the way round. Paul was saying 222.
No, don't libel these two. Paul?
I am 222.
No, you said 264.
No, he never.
No. Petter, you said 222.
No, 264.
No, right. No, okay, sorry for that mistake. Okay, so Petter said 222, and Paul said 264. Which one of those suckers is correct? And whichever one is incorrect, we will be executing them live on air.
Should we do what you found out about your mum?
Yeah, go on.
Right, okay.
Oh, here we go. Look at this.
My mum is an exuberant character.
Yes.
And we went out to this hotel that she used to work
what
at.
What you mean by exuberant character? She's, what, a short woman who's noisy?
Yes.
There we go. I know the
Boom.
Type.
Have you met my mum?
Annoying. I haven't met your mum.
No, she's not annoying. She's personable.
Yeah, OK, annoying, yeah. Yeah.
Anyway, we went out to this thing.
Yes.
At her workplace. She doesn't work there anymore.
Yeah.
Not connected. It was a hotel. They had an Elton John tribute artist playing, okay? It was quite good, actually.
Yeah.
I thought it was going to be rubbish. It was quite good.
I've seen the real Elton John, and he was rubbish.
Was he? Yeah, he
kept everyone waiting. It was like a small private gig for a radio station, What I Done Work At. And it was just him and a piano.
What do you expect? That's what he does.
And everyone was saying, well, he might only do three songs, or he might do an hour. It depends on how he's feeling. All right, Mr. Showbiz, just play some of your hits. Kept us waiting 45 minutes. Little pipsqueak. Anyway, go on.
Should have got the tribute book, yep. And he was really good. Anyway, so halfway through the second act,
yeah,
he says he wants someone to come up and sing "Don't Go Breaking My Heart."
Oh yeah.
My mum straight up.
Your mum wanted to be. She was a Kiki D wannabe.
I've never heard my mum sing before.
Oh.
I thought this is going to end badly. This is going to be awful.
Yes.
Put my head in my hands. I felt about 14 again, you know, embarrassing mum time.
Yeah.
I can hear him starting the singing. And then this voice came out.
Yeah.
She was amazing.
Hey.
She was amazing. And I slowly lifted my head from my hands and looked, and sure enough, it was my mother.
Wowzers.
Singing on a stage and being really good.
Hey, Darren, can your mum sing?
Can my mum sing? I doubt it.
Oh, what have you learnt? Have you called in for the excellent phone-in, What Have You Learnt About Your Mum?
No, I phoned in about Jack's book.
Oh, Jack's book! Jack's book's going to get right up Jack's pencil case.
You know
case.
What Jack's book's going to get?
There we go.
Is the right answer, though?
Was it 222, which is what Petter says, or 264, which is what Paul now says?
It's neither.
Oh, for crying out loud. Please. Go on.
It's 221.
Flipping it. Why do you say that?
Right, it's the same logic as, was it Petter?
Yeah.
The numbers 1 to 9 have one digit each.
Correct.
So there's 9 of them. The numbers 10 to 99 have two digits each.
Yes.
90 of those.
Right.
So 90 times 2 is 180, plus the 9 that you originally had is 189.
Yes.
189 taken away from 555.
Yes.
Is 3. No, it's 3. Yeah, it's 366.
Make it stop.
Oh, for God's sakes. Yes.
It's 366, so 366 divided by 3 is 122. And 122 plus 99 is
First down the rabbit hole has not gone the way I envisioned. Envisaged?
Envisaged.
What's an envisionment then? Exactly, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much indeed. So it turns out it's turned into a maths special. Hey, actually, I've come up with all these good ideas for radio shows, right? I never put them into practice. One of the complaints that we had, one of my favourite complaints we ever had about my show was it's like listening to a private party for 11-year-olds.
Awesome.
Guys, if you knew that 7 o'clock tonight on BBC Three Counties Radio or Radio 4 or 5 Live, they were playing a private recording of a private party for 11, you'd listen.
Of course you would.
You would listen. Of course you would listen. The other idea I had, and Radio 3 kind of nicked it. They didn't actually, but they did. It was completely different, but it was similar in content. My idea was at 10 o'clock, half nine, 10 o'clock, you have going to bed with Steve. And it's Steve, and it's basically him getting ready to go to bed. And it's like him, like, ablutting and brushing his teeth and maybe reading his book or something. Mm-hmm. And he says, well, I'm going to try and get to sleep now. And you hear him blow the candle out. And,
a candle?
Oh, I have candles at the moment. I'm big on candles. And he goes to sleep. You hear him, and you might hear him get up, pee in the night. But it's basically, it's a live broadcast of a man going to sleep. Radio 3 did this the other day.
Did they? Cheeky devils.
Kind of, except it wasn't a man going to sleep. It was an 8-hour piece of music that helps you go to sleep live.
Gosh.
Played live. I know. It's kind of the Ponzi version. But now I'm thinking, not for us to do, although we're doing it, a homework phone-in. Oh, come on. No, come on. Homework phone-in?
Retract.
Why?
Because Mayo already does it.
Who does?
Simon Mayo.
Oh, flipping it. He's still... But like a whole show.
For the whole show?
For the whole show.
All right, put it back in.
Oh, dear. Lynn's in Dunsmore. Afternoon, Lynn.
Hello.
You're right, Lynn. Well, please tell us you've not called in about maths.
I have, sorry.
Oh, don't matter, Lynn. Go on. What you... Well, so far, the answers to this question are 221, 224 or 264. What number are you going to pluck out of the air?
Well, I was going to say 251.
Explain your workings out.
Well, the same workings out as other people have used, but I must admit I'm doubting myself a little bit. But I'll give you an answer to the second question, which was about the number of five.
Oh, yeah.
And that answer was 45.
Why?
Because if you think about the sort of 5, 15, 25, etc., and then you've got to add when you get to 50, 51, 52, and then 150, 51, 52, etc., and then you end up with 250 and 51. But that's obviously making the assumption that 251 was correct.
Exactly, exactly. That's why you've got to get the first one right first, and then you can get onto the next one and maybe get a star. This is going horribly wrong.
Lynn, what have you learned about your mum? He said, desperately trying to get some content that we could use out of this show.
I don't know, really.
Thanks very much indeed. Let's go to Kev, who's in a taxi. Afternoon, Kev.
Hey, afternoon, Iain.
What you got for us, boss?
42.
Oh.
Thanks for calling. No, hang on. What?
No, hold on.
Go on.
That's the number of fives that there are, which was part two. Second question that you asked
what was... We haven't even got the answer to the first question, Kev!
Yes, you have. It's 221.
But how do we know that?
Well, it's very easy.
Talk us through it slowly.
Well, talk us through it quickly and at an abbreviated pace, if you will.
Right, OK, no problem. 1 to 9, one digit.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's 9 in total.
Yeah.
Page 10 through to 99 is 90 pages, 180 digits.
Oh, God, I'm losing the will to live!
Hey, this is good.
Where's the good bit? Where's the good bit?
The good bit will be the end.
189 digits so far. Take from the 555.
Yeah.
6 divided by 3. 122 pages. Still 99. 21.
Right. Do you know what? I'm so fed up with this. I'm going to say, yeah, correct answer. That's
yeah,
the
correct answer, Kev. Wilson's on the line now. We have Wilson's dad. Now we've got Wilson. Afternoon, Wils.
Hello.
At last, a voice full of vim and indeed vigour.
Yes.
You've not called in about the maths, have you?
No.
Good. What have you got for us? Well, the show's starting, guys. Here we go.
Everyone sit up.
Well, I am phoning in.
Yes.
Firstly, to say that I got your reference to Birdie Nom Noms.
Ladies and gentlemen, earlier on in the show, I issued what could only be what would, many people would consider a racist call to arms. I uttered the immortal phrase, Birdie Nom Noms. Nobody, none of the old people here got it. Wilson, you're 11, aren't you? No, hang on a minute. You're not yet 10, are you?
No, only in a few... days.
He's like nine and
weeks,
he's
3 weeks.
3 weeks is it's 21 days, so he's 9 7/8. You got the Birdie Num Nums reference. Please educate my co-presenter.
It's from the movie The Party.
And can you explain? You've not seen it, Catherine.
No, I don't know.
It's good.
Who's in it?
Who's in it? And what happens? Go on.
I actually have no idea.
Did your dad tell you the answer?
Fed the answer.
No, I just saw a clip on YouTube, and I felt. Might as well just watch this.
You might... And was it... Now, OK, this film, I believe, was made in 1968. It stars Peter Sellers as a comedy Indian.
I knew it was Peter Sellers because of the voice.
Birdie Nom Noms. It's Peter Sellers. It's back in the days... and, Wilson, this is unacceptable now. It's back in the day when it was acceptable for white men to play thick Indian men by putting on boot polish and speaking in a funny voice. Did you enjoy the clip that you saw?
Sort of.
Yeah, Jim Wilson. Listen, thank you very much indeed. And that's kind of the reaction that film. It's a strange film, and it ends up with a load of hippies painting an elephant. That's how we got there.
What kind of party is this?
It's a 60s Hollywood party. Oh, that's right. How we got there. Right, we're going to speak to Jamie, then we're going to play... By the way, 03459 455 555. As you've probably picked up, you can call in about anything you want. Yeah. There is no rules.
But we've thrown a couple of things out, haven't we? Times when you found out stuff about your mum.
Yep.
What was the other one?
Decorating animals.
Oh, yeah, that.
There we go. Go on, Cassidy, speak to Jamie.
Jamie, go.
How are we doing?
Oh, that fair? One.
I'm turning my mic off. I can't deal with this.
Now, Grumpy Jamie, how are you feeling today?
I tell you what, this show is shocking, isn't it? Absolutely shocking, but this has got some legs.
You reckon?
It certainly has.
I can guarantee I won't be here next week.
Certainly will be. This is the whole point of it. This is how it should be. A couple of hours of this, talking about anything you want. Great fun.
Go on then. What do you want to talk about?
I've got nothing to talk about. I just wanted to say it was car crash for the first hour.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Couldn't get the record player to work. Loved it. And you both go away from the mic and leave a bloke talking about fossils. You can't beat that.
Do you want a little bit of... I tell you what, Jamie, because I like you. And I'm going to do what I never, ever do, Jamie. I'm going to take a request for you. I've got my computer here, my laptop here of songs. And I'm going to take a request for you. What would you like me to play, boss?
Oh, My Generation by The Who.
Oh, you asked for The Who the other day, didn't you? And,
yeah.
Okay, let me just drag that in. Do you want to introduce it and we'll play it?
We're going to listen to My Generation from The Who on BBC Three Counties.
Not a chance, Jamie. Not a chance at all. I was once on a show with Tony Bennett. I was on a show with Tony Bennett on Radio 4. He was being interviewed by Ned Sherrin, right, for, what was it called, Loose Ends. And I got to Loose Ends a few times. It was one of the weird, always the weird mix of people. I remember being sat next to Dame Kiri Takanawa.
Nice.
Opposite me was Poirot. And I think that may have been the last one I did when I upset a bros. Anyway, Tony Bennett was on it once. And he did his interview. I think he was interviewed at the start of the show. I think he was the first guest that they interviewed. The show went off about an hour. It was pre-recorded, but it was done as live. And as soon as he'd finished his bit, he sat back in his chair, hands on his chest, and if you listen carefully, you could hear a...
Well, he actually... That's
how cool he is. He actually went to sleep.
Not even pretending to listen.
The guy just went to sleep. Now, I think we have a little bit of this. Hang on 1 second.
Travel news for Beds, Cards and Bugs.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
Now, just coming in with reports in St Albans, it's queuing down from the M1, that's on the A414. You've also got waiting time there of up to 40 minutes now. In Luton, the A579 on Leagrave Road, that's also blocked in both directions because of an accident at Blundell Road. Dunstable, it's queuing on the A5 High Street in both directions around Church Street. In Bricketwood, it's looking heavy, quite busy on North Orbital Road now at junction 21A of the M25, that's on the roundabout. And today is the Barduck Fair, and therefore the High Street will remain closed, affecting 5 bus services. And in football, Stevenage play Carlisle today at Broadhall Way with kickoff at 3 p.m. That's the latest. Howard Kassam, BBC Three Counties Radio.
And then it goes to that, and we don't need that. We need this instead. It's all we need. Don't worry,
this
miss. Don't panic.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
Hello, Elton.
Hello.
Elton. Is it the Elton?
No, it's not the Elton, no.
Oh, it's other Elton. What did you want to say, other Elton?
Oh, well, I wanted to offer up a time travel movie that you guys might be interested in.
I bet I've seen it. I've seen every time travel movie going. The best time travel movie, of course, is the Czechoslovakian movie, and it's a great title for a time travel film. Tomorrow, I will burn my hand with a hot cup of tea. It's a real film. It's hard to find. It's flawed slightly because it revolves around identical twins. So that's kind of where the flaw is. But otherwise, it involves going back in time to kill Hitler. Oh, yes, sir.
What's the cup of tea relevance then?
He knows that he's travelled back in time because he goes, oh, hang on a minute, tomorrow I'm going to burn myself with a hot cup of tea. And he does.
Oh, right. He does.
Right, okay. Elton, what have you got for us?
I offered you one on Twitter yesterday called Time Machine.
Oh, mate, I watched it. It's a corker, 5 minutes long. Yeah. It's brilliant. Did you watch it? I retweeted it.
I will, though.
Oh, it's brilliant. Thank you. Okay, go on. Excellent.
Well, I've got another one for you.
Yes, boss.
It's called Mouse X.
Flipping heck already. It's the sexiest film title I've ever heard
in my
life. No,
Mouse X.
Okay, right, yes, go on.
It's about a guy who's in a experiment, shall we say?
Right.
Well, is it an experiment?
It's an experiment, yes.
Then you're right to say it, yes.
And it is wonderful. It is 15 minutes long.
Yeah.
I think it blows the one that I tweeted to you yesterday out of the water. It's not. It's a different cup of tea too. I'll wake up tomorrow and scald myself with tea.
Have you seen that film?
Yeah, it's on YouTube now.
Oh, they said, well, everyone, go and discover it on YouTube. How come you only like short films?
I love long films as well. I do like the short film. It just it's nice and easy, in and out. If you don't like it, you forget about it. If you like it, brilliant. Share it.
Have you seen the Cube trilogy?
I've seen the Cube. I haven't seen the trilogy, though. I'm not sure if they're going to be bobbins or not.
Well, you said the second one was bobbins, so why did they make another one?
Well, the second one, the acting is even worse than the first one, with very poor special effects. But I watched it, and I started watching the third one last night, the prequel. Hey, this is what I'm doing this evening. Right, Elton, you did this, right? And I'm not a massive fan of these films, but for our kids, we do anything, right? And actually, I'm quite excited by it. My 5-year-old and my 3-year-old are watching these hideous cartoons called Star Wars The Clone Wars.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah, hideous. Absolutely hideous, right? He keeps asking, who's that, who's that? I said, I don't know. I only really know, and I don't know it that well. I only know the original Star Wars, okay? And he says, oh, who's in that? And I'm talking about Luke Skywalker and Han Solo. And he keeps saying, can we watch it? And I said, well, they're a bit grown up. He says, I won't mind a scary film. So I've bought the Star Wars trilogy, right? And tonight, I think we're having a Star Wars party. And we're certainly going to watch, me and my two boys are going to watch the first ever Star Wars.
It's brilliant.
Oh, wicked.
He's going to be excited. Here's the thing, though, right? So I bought the... It's 2015, right? So I bought the DVD box set, and there's so many different varieties of these three films, okay? Guess how many extras are in this DVD box set?
I have no idea.
Absolutely zero. Not one.
Aren't they tight?
Not one DVD extra.
Can I suggest something while you watch the movie?
Yeah, go on.
Build a fort.
Elton, have you got kids?
I certainly have, yes.
Well, then they are very, very lucky to have a dad like you. Excellent. A fort. We call it a den in our house, but oh, yes, that's going to happen. 03459 455 555. All right, Todd Rundgren's son. I think it's Todd Rundgren's son.
Sounds like him.
Sounds, doesn't it? Doesn't it just so? I met Todd Rundgren. What a nice gentleman. Here we go. People who you never expect. 03459 455 555. Rabbit hole. It's an experiment. It's going to take a few weeks to evolve. Thank you for your patience. You can call in about anything, anytime you want. Here's something I was reminded of the other day. And this is the people who you thought going to be complete and utter backsides, but actually turned out to be lovely.
You.
Sorry?
I thought you were going to be...
What do you mean? Did you really?
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah, I did.
Wow. We can do this on the air. Why?
Just the way you sort of waltzed in and that.
What do you mean the way I waltzed? I'm a dancer. Very light on my feet. And that's not a euphemism anymore. I've got light feet.
Yeah, I just did. I just assumed that you would be because, you know, you're always a tiny bit scary on the 11 o'clock show.
You know that wasn't me on the 11 o'clock show.
I know that now.
You know that I was a boy and I was manipulated freely. It wasn't against my will, but I was manipulated into that kind of role. And I went along with and did it. But not realising, of course, that then I would be perceived as that person forever afterwards. And it weren't really me.
Well, I know that now.
But so you thought I'd be what? How did you
be
think
sarky,
I'd be?
Sarky.
Me? Sarky? Ooh, blimey. You see? Thank you very much.
I thought you'd be impossible to deal with, and I was right.
You can bend me, shape me, any way you want me. As long as you love me, it's all right.
No, I can confirm he's actually all right.
03459 455 555. If you've ever met me and you thought I was going to be rude, I tell you who. I was absolutely delightful. Liam Gallagher.
Yeah, I bet he is.
From the Oasis.
I think he might be doing a voice as well, though.
I was backstage at the Royal Albert Hall. I had to introduce The Who live on stage, the highlight of my career. It's all downhill since then. I also had to introduce the BDIs on stage. I weren't that bothered about that, but it was part of the deal. And I'm stood there, and I could see Liam Gallagher about 10 feet away, right? And I hadn't introduced his band yet. So I was pretending to do that thing where you look at your phone. So I was looking at the phone, pretending that...
busy.
Interesting. And then I saw a shadow was cast over the phone. And I looked up, and there's Liam Gallagher, just stood there, politely. And he went, "All right, mate, just thought I'd introduce myself. My name's Liam, nice to meet you."
Oh.
Liam Gallagher said that.
All right, mate.
Just thought I'd introduce myself. My name's Liam. Pleased to meet you. That is classy.
That is classy. His brother just winked at me.
What, just now?
No.
Oh, well.
I mean, that's all he did. It was nice, really? Though. I was pretending I wasn't bothered.
Well, you're not excited by those rock plums.
Yeah.
Wowzers.
I was quite. People, it was the early 90s.
People who you thought were going to be rude and nasty, but actually turned out to be absolute gentlemen, or indeed ladies.
Do you know who was an absolute legend I knew would be?
Go on. Was it Roger Daltrey?
Noddy Holder.
Yeah.
What a lovely man.
Didn't you have a thing with Noddy Holder?
No, I didn't have a thing with Noddy Holder.
I thought you'd had a thing with Noddy Holder.
What defined thing?
Intercourse.
No!
No? Is that's the rumour that's going around.
Only social.
Okay. Well.
Intercourse at the pub.
Okay.
There were other people there.
But you didn't think that Noddy Holder was going to be...
Well, sometimes when they seem that nice, you think they're not going to be that way in real life.
Noddy Holder's always going to be nice.
Yeah, I knew he was going to be a good one.
Noddy Holder was always going to be nice.
Nice fella. Nice fella.
03459 455 555. What you got about the bus? Go on, I saw
this. This traffic bust up, it says in the Daily Mirror this morning.
Yeah.
Stand off for 4 hours as drivers refuse to back down over right-of-way row.
I won't back down, baby!
Yeah, it went like that. Yeah. A bus and an oncoming car brought traffic to a standstill for 60 minutes in a row over who had right-of-way. Motorists looked on in dismay as half-mile queues built up in both directions. Lads, sort it out. Just kiss and get it over with.
I respect both of the people involved. Both of the people are heroes in my book.
I would have knocked their heads together. Bus driver Omar Razvi, 42, even read a paper at the wheel. He was that not bothered.
Yeah.
As drivers pleaded with him and Ewan Langley, who was young and covered in tattoos. The standoff only ended when police asked Mr. Langley to reverse, and he went, "Yeah, right then."
He bottled it. Both of those gentlemen have got gahonas the size of Bristol's. I mean, that's just... To be that stubborn... I've been involved in situations like that, and to be that...
Yeah, but after half an hour, you think, maybe I'm taking this too far.
You know, I spent an hour and 15 minutes in a phone shop because they...
used me as a decoy.
They knackered my phone. You know how I got out of there? Did I see how I got out of there?
Yeah.
I had to text Paul Scoynes and say, "Paul, you've got to phone me up and you just have to repeat in my ear, walk out of the shop. Walk out of the shop. Whatever I say, repeat it." So Paul Scoynes phones up, and I went, "Hello," and he went, "Hello," and I went, "Yeah," he went, "Yeah." I said, "Haven't you got something you should be saying to me?" And he went, "Haven't you got something?" Oh, I misunderstood. And then he's in my ear going, "Walk out of the shop. Walk out of the shop."
Yeah.
Raj is on the line. Afternoon, Raj.
Afternoon. How are you guys?
Yeah, you know what? We're surviving. We're surviving the light. What have you got for us, boss?
I'm afraid. All I was ringing up about was the fact that we're all stuck in a massive traffic jam between the M1 and the A414 into St Albans.
Oh, for goodness sakes! What the hell is going on, Raj? What have you done now?
Well, we're having fun sitting on the side of the grassy bank, picking apples off the side. So
you've got that far.
Wowzers!
You've been there that long.
Yeah.
You've been there so long, you're actually resorting to crime to feed your family.
Crime, it's sharing. It's sharing.
Do you know what? It really makes me so uncomfortable on motorways when people start getting out and start kicking a football. I've seen people kick a football around.
I saw a brilliant one once, right? There was this woman walking up and down. There's always one that starts it, isn't there? And then everyone else starts getting out of the cars and everything. It was a really hot day. I was very pregnant. I wasn't moving. I just had the window open. So...
Can you turn your phone off, mate?
Yeah, I really should.
Flipping heck.
Blimey, go away. So, I'm sitting in the car thinking, look at her. Yeah. And I noticed in my rear view...
It was a reflection.
No, everyone was laughing as she walked by.
Uh-oh.
And I thought, what's going on there?
No.
She walked past my car.
Yeah.
Skirts tucked in her knickers.
Ladies and gentlemen, how is that even... Raj, thank you for that. If anyone knows what the hell is going on, thank you very much indeed. How is that even possible, Gatford, to tuck your skirt into your knickers?
It's very simple.
How?
If you whip your kecks up quick, sometimes you catch your skirt in them.
But you'd know. You would know that anus was on display.
It would feel breezy.
I know when I tuck my jeans into my socks, so...
And it's exactly the same thing, isn't it?
Exactly.
But wearing a skirt... But wearing a skirt is breezy, you see, so you might not know.
I've had cause to wear kilts, and you don't wear pants with a kilt. That's what's a Scotsman got under his kilt? His genitals. That's basic. That's a fact.
Is it because it's restrictive, or is that just tradition?
I think it's just a filthy, disgusting, unhygienic tradition.
Do you know what I think it's about? Oh. Yeah. Them showing how, I'm going to use a different word,
hard.
How tough they are.
I just realised
that. People from Newcastle not wearing shirts.
Exactly.
It's something very freeing, but it is perverted. Kilts are perverted. Scots people are perverted. And I can say that because my grandfather was a Scotchman. He was a Scotchman in every sense of the words.
How about next week we all wear skirts for the show?
If you want to do that, mate. I mean, I can't think of anything more unattractive than your backside. But...
I've got to talk about anything else.
Okay. What have you got for us, Gafford?
I met Dougie Anderson at one of your gigs.
Dougie Anderson, for those who don't know, is another Scotch gentleman, was one of my best friends until I offended him mercilessly by saying something I shouldn't have said, and now we hardly talk. But them's the breaks. Oh. Them's the breaks.
Okay. Well, I thought, because he's quite a verbose gentleman, I thought he'd be really hard to talk to. But he was lovely, and I got a hug at the end of the evening.
Dougie Anderson is one of the... some of you may have seen him on television a bit. He's one of the nicest gentlemen. How could you... How could you think he would be anything but... I tell you who's... Should I say this?
Yeah, I'm going to tell you why I thought that way.
Yeah, go on.
Just quickly. Just because he talks a lot, I thought he might be really intelligent and not able to get along with like people of lesser intelligence like
me. He's as thick as anything.
Is he?
Here you go. Here's someone. I'm going to say this on the radio, and this now totally ruins... this now ruins any chance of ever working with a gentleman. People who you think... We can play it the other way around. People who you think might be nice, but actually in real life can be hard work. Ladies and gentlemen, Peter Talk of the Monkeys. I said it out loud.
Wow.
I said it out loud.
I suspect that gentleman does that on purpose.
I suspect we should have the rest of this conversation off air. But unless you're a hot lady, boy oh boy, it can be. He's been very charming. I've seen him be very charming. I've seen him shout abuse at someone who dared to offer him a Monkees record and a Sharpie. Shouted abuse. I mean, really, guys.
One last thing. Why is your name first in the show? Not
Kath. Because I'm the best.
Because the best. Listen, this is the reason why. Because the bosses don't like me as much. My coat is on a very, very rusty nail. I can tell you now I will not be here next week.
That's not a rusty nail.
They'll get someone else in. You wait and see.
Okay. Well,
that's the truth. You wanted the truth. I gave you the truth.
You wanted the truth? We've got to be quiet. It's Sir Julian of Cope on next. Stay there, okay. Phil. Come to you after this.
Don't world shut your mouth.
Why are we don't introduce songs. I was giving you the finger to say, tell them who the hell we are, for crying out loud.
We're Iain Lee and Katherine Boyle. You can guess which one's which. I'm not going to deliver this to you on a silver platter.
She's got the bigger doodah than I have.
I
Phil's
certainly
on the
have.
Line. Good afternoon, Phil.
Hello, Iain. How you doing?
Phil, I've got really... Now, what is it? What is it about coffee that gives you such bad indigestion? My, I'm going to be all over the shop. My chest just isn't working.
It's just a piece of coffee.
Do you know what? I thought that the gold blend stuff was the good stuff.
You want to ditch the whole thing altogether?
Oh, maybe I do. What you got for us, Philip?
Robbie Williams. I used to work in a casino in London, and he used to come in on the odd occasion.
Oh, yes.
And he was... I would have expected him to have been really arrogant, but he wasn't. He was really, really nice. Very, 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 very subdued.
Yeah, I bet if you got Robbie back in the days when he was coked off his nut, and he would be the first person to say that, I suspect he would have been a bit of
a pain
and indeed a show-off. But I imagine, I like to make up that he's been through the mill so much that he's like an all right bloke now. He's come back out t'other side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so.
What did you say? What did you say to him? Did you go up to him and go, "All right, Robbie, can I have a selfie?"
No, no, you couldn't do that, could you? I was on a reception there, so you have to be supposedly professional when they came in. But he came in and he actually introduced himself. When he played roulette, he introduced himself to the cruisers. Hello, he says, "I'm Robbie." And,
whereas I suspect that who's the moonface boy in Take That?
What, Gary?
Barlow. I suspect Barlow is the complete opposite.
Probably,
do you know what I mean?
On the other side of it, I met Rod Stewart in a similar situation.
Yeah.
And he was bit the opposite, really. But working on reception, we relied upon tips as part of our income, and Rod wasn't particularly forthcoming with his gratuity.
How much of a tip, I've got to ask, how much of a tip did Rod Stewart give?
Minus, it came nothing.
Oh.
Minus.
I've heard that about him, though, that he's a bit tight.
He put his hand in the pot and took a couple of quid out. One of my colleagues
worked in one of the major hotels in Mayfair.
Yeah.
Where Rod Stewart went and had a meal. He managed to consume 3/4 of a bottle of red wine, and then he decided to send it back.
Cheeky devil.
Cheeky devil. Phil, thank you for that. We've come to the end. We've staggered to the end of our first show. Katherine, would you like to say anything before we have some of the Beach Boys?
I would. I'd like to say I can only apologise.
Yeah.
And we'll try and do better next time.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
It matters a bit.
travel news for beds, cards and bugs.
BBC Three Counties Radio.
Now in St Albans, the A414 is blocked in both directions at Watling Street and the roundabout. That's also queuing there, that's all because of the accident. Now there are delays on all approaches to the roundabout, that's all because of the accident there. In North Watford, it's looking slow still on North Western Avenue, southbound at the Dome roundabout. In Luton, still there's reports of Lee Grave Road being blocked in both directions at Marsh Road.
Ollie, I don't know what happens here, and also I don't know if you can hear me. Can you hear me? You can hear me. I'm just going to play this and I'm going to shut up and say nothing. You've got control. Beautiful. Thank you, Bob.
Counties Radio.
That's it. That's your lot. We'll be back next Saturday, midday till 2. I will also be back Monday as well at 6 o'clock, but we're going to shut up now. Ta-ta!
Local and vocal across beds, hearts and bucks.
This is BBC Three Counties Radio.
Yes, good afternoon. Thanks to Iain and Katherine. I'm Jeff Doyle. Good afternoon. Already the leagues are beginning to take shape and fans are beginning to see what's in store for their side this season. But do you like what you see?
It's Saturday. It's Saturday. It's 12 o'clock. It's time for Three Counties Sport. With live coverage of Watford.
Odion Ighalo scores in the Premier League again!
MK Dons.
And it's in there! It's a goal! Simon Church gets a goal for Mill Kings Dons.
Luton.
And McGeehan finds the back of the net. Best move of the match from the Hatters.
Stevenage.
Header comes in. It's Fraser Franks who's got it.
And Wickham.
It's there! What a goal by Michael Harriman. His second of the afternoon.
Follow your team every step of the way with Three Counties Sport.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm Jeff Doyle on the south coast here in Bournemouth. Four commentary matches today to keep you entertained. Here, Watford take on the team that pipped them to the championship title last season. Then it was all about the glory. Now it's about survival. Troy Deeney will play a major part in that and is so, even though he's yet to get off the mark.
This kind of a stadium, like Bournemouth, is a small stadium. It's very difficult to create a space. So maybe we have to do something different in respect to this game.
Yes, the manager, Kike Flores, may just tinker with the system as well this afternoon. We shall see. In the Championship, MK Dons are away to the only side below them in the table. A huge match at Bristol City. The Dons are on a horrendous run. 6 defeats in a row, 5 in the league. But the boss won't change his footballing principles.
We have to persevere. If we keep doing this, we'll win football matches. I think it's easy, because it's easy winning games when you're playing the way we do when you're winning. Playing the way we do when things aren't going your way takes immense bravery and respect for the way we do it. And every single one of my players, I can't question any of them.
In League Two, the picture for our clubs is similar to what it was this time last season. Wickham flying, Luton not far off, and Stevenage drifting. The Hatters have won their last three and are getting there.
The most important thing for me is we keep improving all the time. I believe that we will get sharper. I know we'll get stronger. I know there'll be more power in our game. I also know that there's going to be hiccups because it's football.
Stevenage have lost their last three and the boss accepts the fans' grumbles.
I've got no complaints with the supporters. They come here, they pay their money, same as any supporters around the country. They voice their opinions about what they see and I've got no problem with the supporters whatsoever, ever. I'm judging my players and I'm as harsh on them as what anybody is.
Well, leaders Wickham continue to thrive under Gareth Ainsworth. Will they be able to keep the manager at Adams Park?
We came here 5 years ago, me and the family, and like I say, we're settled. I'm really happy. The football's good. The fans are great. Things are going well. I'm not about to be looking elsewhere. Natural things take their course, and if they don't, fantastic.
This is Three Counties Sports from BBC Three Counties Radio.